Sorry?
Ik zei dat bij de energiemensen kregen we eerst een veiligheidsinstructie. Dus ik ben niet zo benieuwd wat er gaat gebeuren.
Nee, ik ga niet de nooduitgang.
Geen live vest.
Geen luistervest. Welcome everybody to KLM Digital Studio. Very nice to welcome you all. It's a big group with some high quality people I just heard. So we're gonna rock tonight. I just want to start with a short movie, then do a short introduction, and then we dive into the content.
Simply amazing. I mean, look at them. So dedicated to make a difference. Whoops, sorry. I forgot to introduce myself. My name's Rick, proud software developer and part of digital transformation. Let me tell you something about my everyday life working at this amazing company. It's a fast-moving world out there, and technology just doesn't stop transforming. Survival of the rich does not apply in this industry. So let me tell you my story of the savviest. Let's first look at how we do digital at E&M. My buddy here, James, now has instant access to the expertise of his fellow colleagues, and we're helping him by decreasing the time he's looking for the instructions he needs. Now he has much more time to put his hands on metal, and he loves it. Boom! We've decreased the turnaround time of this Dreamliner with costly minutes. How's that for feeling proud and appreciated at a corporate giant? We also transform our traditional administration processes. We make everything digital. Give my colleagues tools and apps that matter and eliminate process waste. To be honest, that is where the pros distinguish themselves from the amateurs. I feel as being part of a special mission, the kind of mission where an employee comes first. And at IT, my time is precious. I can create whatever you want. I can deliver whenever you want. But really, that's not what it's about. It's the art of agile development that drives me and my team towards the greater good. And the final results are endless. The art of transportation. It's in our human DNA for centuries. Looks pretty straightforward, right? But is it really just moving a package from A to B? Just simply imagine what the world would look like from the package's eyes. So, yeah, sure, your old legacy systems can run for a few more decades. That is, if all other airlines in the world would do the same. But I've got some cool stuff up my sleeves for you. Wait and see.
So, welcome to KLM. What do we do? We as KLM just bring people from A to B. And we already do that now for 99 years. So in October this year, it's going to be our 100th birthday, the oldest airline in the world, still operating under its own name. And during those 99 years, we have seen like a lot of different changes. In 1929, we just introduced the world's longest distance flight from Amsterdam to Batavia. In 91, we were the first airline in Europe with a frequent flyer program. In 99, we attained our first ISO standard certification. In 2006, we were the world's first airline to introduce self-service transfer kiosk. And those are just some of the milestones that we have achieved the last 99 years. So pioneering and being innovative, that's part of our DNA. And that's, I think, also where you're standing here. You're standing in the center of our kind of pioneering area. And this is the place where it all happens. So this is really moving your world. And it's not been like the last 99 years, but this continues. And that's why in 2016, we just set up this digital studio. Just a place where we facilitate all those innovative things and inspire the rest of our company with the latest technology. So what do we do? Just in a very high level nutshell, we experiment and build chatbots I think from a social media hub, that's the one that most of you maybe know. We do a lot of things with data. Biometrics is one of the areas. Blockchain, of course, AR, VR, MR, IoT. These are just some of the things that we are doing here. So zooming in on blockchain, what is our ambition for 2020? Our vision is that we want to make travel hassle-free. We want to monetize the data and have a high-performing organization by applying blockchain technology. And our mission is just to build a blockchain center of excellence by building up internal knowledge, delivering products, and showing thought leadership. So what did we do last year? Specifically with the blockchain topic, we started Q4 2017 with starting up this program. And last year, actually, we've been experimenting. So it was basically in an experimenting phase with five different use cases. So the first one is with engineering and maintenance. So tracking the components lifecycle on the blockchain. Second one is with our catering services, KCS, where we put the certificates, so the quality certificates on the blockchain to make it transparent for all the different parties in the chain. Together with IATA Finance, we created tokens which we want to replace for our current vouchers that are being handed out during disruptions. We finalized the use case with our finance department, so seeing if intercompany settlements could be done via the blockchain. And last but not least, and that's why we are here, that's the one that is linked to Seamless Flow, which we do together with CX, that stands for Customer Experience, and that's where Jordi comes in later on. So the ambition for this year has been set by the executive committee in November last year. They were convinced and they also saw the lessons learned that we retrieved from the five prototypes that we've delivered last year. And they said, well, 2019 is going to be in the picture of scaling. Well, with scaling, I think we all know that we need the ecosystem around it to really implement the blockchain-based solution. And that's also very closely linked with the theme of Dutch Chain, of communization. And what they clearly said is that they really want to scale with this biometric seamless flow topic. So that is my short introduction. I will come back later on. I'm glad that you all embarked this flight. And let's take off. Give the floor to...
Yeah, okay, switching the mic. Yeah, dat kun je beter dan ik. Ja, dankjewel.
Ja.
Thanks, Linda en Jordi. For making us feel welcome here in the innovative heart of KLM. It's really cool that KLM has also embarked on the Odyssey and that we can further explore this tonight together. So I invite you all to ask a lot of questions because this is one of the most exciting challenges we have at the hackathon, I think. If you look at the topic of digital identity, in where a lot of people in the blockchain space, but also far beyond that, are talking about, then there's one single really important thing is how do we handle all the biometric stuff in a safe way? So this is spot on. When we heard from Linda and Jordi that this was one of the things they were considering as a challenge in the hackathon, we were, of course, immediately enthusiastic from the get-go. I see some familiar faces, but a lot of new faces as well. That is very, very good. So were any of you in our first hackathon in 2017? Okay, really good. It was a bit of a odyssey, but we didn't know it yet. because I was basically working on two things. Really crazy, nerdish, almost near stupid experiments, like creating a Bitcoin wallet for Google Glass and make hands-free payments a reality. Nobody needs it, but it was a lot of fun to do. Just experiment with this new technology. See where you can take this new type of technology into things that were not possible before. And on the other hand, I was organizing meetings. Bitcoin cafes to talk with entrepreneurs and use Bitcoin to buy beer. That went very well. But also the more serious type of Bitcoin conferences. That's where we started with ABN AMRO and ING. And then we did a blockchain conference, and it was, you know, the conferences. You have a stage, people are on it, everybody claps. I sold tickets, was happy, and everybody went home. So I was not really happy because not a lot of stuff was happening. Right? So then I thought, well, if we can combine these things, what do we get then? So I moved from organizing the Dutch Blockchain Conference towards organizing this, the Dutch Blockchain Hackathon. And I expected about, well, if we have 200 people there, that would be very nice because then we would have the biggest blockchain hackathon in Europe. But then it turned out 55 teams from 10 countries and over 500 people. So there they are. We seem to somehow stretch the limits of what's possible in a certain building. Maybe you could see it here a bit as well. But the results from that hackathon still resonate and ripple out through the ecosystem. So for example, when we started this week, the track deep dives at APG, they were able to present the winner from the APG track, the future of pensions. It's one of the startups they have incubated, they've invested in, and they have recently launched their product. And now you can buy through tokens solar panels that are not on top of your own roof, and you can just buy parts of it. So imagine if you could do that with your pension. Well, then that could be interesting, right? So it's still, and a lot of other teams, they are still very, very active and gain clients and funding. But we didn't really know where it would lead because, well, Ethereum was quite new. We were discovering how smart contracts would work and especially also where to fit the solutions in the grander scheme of things, in the grander perspective. And the second version, who was there? Already a bit more. we did it, of course. It was nice to do it a second time, but everybody brought a lot of more knowledge there. We had over 200 experts there already, and you can see the quality of what comes out of it already rising. Back then we had just 64 teams from 22 countries. And the exciting part is still that a lot of teams that came out of it are making progress with investments, with clients. And we had the birth of a protocol there. So this week on Monday, the winners of the machine-to-machine economy track, JP is sitting over there. He is the supporter, backer, leader of that track, which is now Nature 2.0. If you want paradigm shifts happening on the spot, then just talk to JP for 5 minutes and it's done. They now, the team of Crya presented their solution on last Monday, where they released an open source SDK as a building block for the teams this year to use it for autonomous swarm robotics. So if you want, let's say, self-flying airplanes in the future, which autonomously decide where they are needed most, stuff like that, then there's a protocol for that. Of course, in its infancy, but it started. They actually made it work. And this year, we rebranded to Odyssey, odyssey.org. And I want to take you into a preview of what's coming up in April.
Hey, hey, hey! You're not into cryptocurrency to make a quick buck. You're in this because you're building a system that enables everyone to participate and benefit. You're not in blockchain to make the status quo more efficient. You're in this to reinvent the way we organize society for the 21st century. You're part of a global movement. Our biggest problems today are shared problems. Problems no one owns. Problems that we need to solve together in the commons.
We need interconnected collaborative communities, and they need new digital public infrastructure to support that. This is infrastructure that nobody owns, but everybody can use and build on top of that.
This April, 1,500 selected pioneers will be on the move from all over the world.
You bring together the coders, you bring together people with the creative ideas and the potential clients, you know, the businesses. So it's the government and the corporates.
This will be the third edition of the biggest blockchain hackathon on Earth. 20 challenges by corporate and governmental launching partners, 100 teams, 200 supporting experts, including regulators, €200,000 in cash rewards, connecting ecosystems, unlocking new markets, discovering the future by actually building it together. This is the way to move beyond the hype toward the commonization of our digital public infrastructure. Join 1,500 builders in Groningen, the Netherlands. We have prepared. Real challenges are waiting for real solutions.
When we initiate such an infrastructure, you unlock a completely new market for everybody in the space.
We are offering you a new market with launching partners that understand why you are in this space. They will build with you. Team registrations are open from January 18th until February 25th. Unlock your potential. Build your odyssey.
Glad to see some laughs during the opening remarks of the BitConnect guru, huh? Being the world's biggest blockchain and AI hackathon is nice, but it's not really about that. We have really chosen, not just us, but we evaluate each year with the complete ecosystem at the Brightland Smart Services Campus in Heerlen. What resonates most with us is that we believe that we don't need more data monopolies, more surveillance capitalistic entities. On the other hand, we want also a better balance between what the government is organizing and what the private sector is organizing. So this new place, the commons, where new protocols are not owned by an entity, can be a really good solution. It turns out we're already doing that. So what is the most successful internet protocol in the world? Anyone? TCP/IP. Then the HTTP protocol, we use email, not owned by anyone. Bitcoin, not owned by anyone. Ethereum, etc., etc. So these infrastructures are already there, and they allow us to collaborate in totally new ways. And it turns out that you can build a lot more of these types of infrastructures. And it also turns out that a lot of projects that started, whether that is from the enterprise point of view or from the more open blockchain communities point of view, started somewhere with the use cases. And then they found out that you can build the use case. It's like having the car, but if you don't have the shared infrastructure, you have no traffic and you have no adoption. So 99.99999% of the projects find out. So this is what we really believe in, and we also have a market vision for that. If we look at the market unfolding the next 10 to 15 years, perhaps a bit longer, then we have the protocol layer where you see new protocols coming up, like the Ocean Protocol. It's now live. And it's also a commonized protocol, so to say. And then you immediately see how fast other communities step in and build on it. It's growing really fast globally. And on top of that, you need the products and services. You need, for email, you need the Gmails, the Hotmails, the clients. You need the services. So that's where you unlock the market. And if you're involved in developing that protocol together with all kinds of partners and stakeholders, that's where you have a great position to pick your clients, basically, right? So this is this is not rocket science. We can all do this. We see also this transformation in our ecosystem, because what we thought initially when we founded the hackathon as an innovation program is that we need a market where clients truly understand where the technology can make a difference, and not just, well, let's say, do with the internet what newspapers has done with the internet, right? We're at paywalls now, so woohoo. So it's really understanding that this is a type of solution where we build things that cannot be solved by just one organization, where this is something where a lot of complexity is there, and where a lot of stakeholders and different types of organizations, in the ideal situation, humans individually, can contribute to a part of the solution. That's why we heavily invest in preparing the challenges in a way that they make sense, because they have this interconnected and decentralized nature. And we find out how to enable all the participants in the network of the challenge to contribute to a better situation. And the teams are also preparing in a great way this year. Imagine from now on to the hackathon, we have a lot of time. And we have the collaborative infrastructure with the community, with these types of meetings, where you can really prepare. We have on the 8th of March an ethical deep dive to, let's say, calibrate the ethical compass we use, and we do that in the Dutch Senate together, the partners and the team captains. So we really focus on preparing to learn as much about the context of the challenge as possible. And then we go to the hackathon, because this is the place where you will leverage what you have prepared with your ability to get rid of all the assumptions you still have, right? This is the place where all the experts, for example, from KLM, but perhaps also customs or Schiphol or other stakeholders, can be in the room and work with you on the same side of the table, so to say. But there will be also experts from the legal side, for example, from Loyens and Loof, who they know things about privacy, GDPR, stuff like that. Or biometrics experts, or chip experts, or what have you, whatever you need. So please also tell us what you need at the hackathon to leverage all the knowledge that's there and make it work. So on Thursday, everybody, most of the people come in, like 80 or 90%, because they don't want to miss the masterclasses. With all the experts there, it's a no-brainer to do an afternoon full of masterclasses, and all the entrepreneurs in Groningen open up their offices, welcome you, and that's where the masterclasses take place. And then, of course, we have a welcoming party, try not to get lost in the nightlife of Groningen, because it doesn't end. We have no closing times for bars and stuff like that. So then on the Friday, the winning teams, they use this Friday to validate their ideas and to... nice. I think mind your step. Oh no. And they pivot. Most of them pivot. And that's a really good thing. We open at about 12 o'clock, so it's easy going. But then, of course, it's go, go, go. And on Sunday, for all the challenges, jury panel members will assess the solutions and pick the winners. The winners will continue to the Monday. So we have 20 teams there. And this is kind of special that this takes place. It's a new thing. So imagine that we have the Monday, and for each challenge, the key stakeholders and decision makers, but also investors, journalists, etc., will be there to meet with the teams and find out how they can help them forward towards adoption and further development. So yeah, that's going to be quite something. Team selection is really focused on the one hand, you have the quality of the team, but also really important is the motivation. Why do you want to work with, for example, KLM? How will you deal with, what if you win? How will you deal with that? What are you going to do? For example, if you're a corporate team, will you go back to the 9-to-5 or 9-to-10 job you have? Or if you're a startup, what do you need then? And what are your ambitions after the hackathon? So we judge a lot on potential when selecting the teams. We have until February 25th. However, we have already started confirming teams. Today, we confirmed the first team for this challenge. So, Patrick, are you? Yeah, your team got confirmed. So there's 4 spots left, huh? Well, this week is me and the team are like a traveling circus throughout the Netherlands. 1,000 people in total, something like that, visit all the deep dives. Tomorrow we have the last 2 of them, 3 sort of, because we're presenting our own challenge as well. So if you have any questions about them, in the beginning of next week, all the slides, as far as we can get them, will be on the website, and you will be informed through email about it. Yeah, I want to wish you a great I hope you learn a lot today, but also you have a lot of interaction with the people of KLM, with each other, to not see if your solution could work, but what you can find out about the context of the challenge, because that's where they are the expert, and they need your creativity to come up with unexpected solutions which they could not have thought of themselves. So that's what we are trying to accomplish here today together. And I wish you a great time this evening. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all for coming over to KLM Digital Studio. I'm very pleased to be here and to give you the context of our challenge. My name is Jordi Knoppes, and to give you a small introduction of myself, I thought what could be more, I would say the Dutch word, more lief or cozy than just to give you my birthday treat, because it's my birthday today, and I thought maybe to give you a small reminder like I did at class, this is my name, so if you get really angry at me, you can eat me at least, so no problem, so
thank you.
Here you are. So, and actually to save time, I think this will go by itself, right? Well, No, don't close. That was not the intention, of course. Okay. Thank you very much. You cannot make me more shy now, of course. You can imagine that. Okay, well, we go to the content, because that's easy. Does it work? Yeah. A small introduction. Actually, this challenge is all about biometrics and blockchain, as we said. Maybe it's also a little bit about biometrics and artificial intelligence. I leave that up to your creativity. But we have to deal with a lot of issues within air transport. And as IATA, our International Air and Transport Association, predicted that within now and 20 years, the air travelers will be doubled. So that means that it will grow to 7.4 billion air travelers. That's a lot. That's really a lot. I don't know if you have followed the newspapers. If you look at Schiphol here, in the high seasons, it's hardly possible to process all those people currently. So let's imagine what will happen in a few years. So we need to look for different solutions to process all those people and to also meet the growth in here. Security, as you can imagine, in an airline industry, it's highly important. You see a lot of geopolitical tension. It's very complex if you look at all those regulations and security policies. Terrorism is a real subject in our business. So, well, security is an issue, I can say. Nothing is happening with my... Ah, there you go. Hopefully it will work out. If you look at our current airport process, people need to authenticate themselves. So it's not just an identification, like we look for Linda in a huge group, and then we find Linda. No, if you are at a touch point, you need to prove that you are you. Currently, we swipe your passport, we check your visa, we do a face match by a human being, and then we do some checks at the background, and then we say, okay, you are good to travel. But the way we do it is very inconsistent, actually. Like when you do a booking, you need to show your passport. When you do a purchase, we need your credit card details. When you check in, we need your booking code or your ticket number. And then also your passport, actually. And then we issue a boarding pass for you. When you go to Backdrop, you need to show your boarding pass and you need to show your passport. And if you have over luggage, we need your credit card details again. At security, to access the security filter where you have to release your belt and to show your luggage, we need your boarding pass here at Schiphol, but at other airports, they also need your passport. To cross the border, we need your passport, of course. To enter the lounge, our crown lounge, you can enter with your passport, or you can enter with your boarding pass, or with your Flying Blue card. That's another one, because we have a loyalty program. When you buy an upgrade, business class seat, for example, we need your credit card details again. Maybe you want to buy some duty-free articles, you need to show your boarding pass and your credit card. And finally, at boarding, you need to show your boarding pass and your passport. Well, and then you can depart here from Schiphol. But if you want to return, you will see that every airport has its own characteristics and its own processes, so that might be a little bit different as well. So that's what I said in the beginning. It's very inconsistent, it's confusing, it creates stress for people, and it generates long queues. So that's really what we don't want. If we look in our vision at our future authentication, then sometimes it works, but sometimes it doesn't. There you go. I will do it from here. Then I'm out of view, I guess. If you look at future authentication, we still want you to make a booking, of course, and preferably to pay it. And then you can think of an enrollment, a biometrical enrollment. And that's key in the whole process, because what we do over there is we capture your face, we match it with the passport photo that is stored on your passport chip. We connect your boarding pass details and we connect your credit card details. And from that moment, when it is trustworthy, your face is your new token, as we say it. So your face is your new passport, your new boarding pass, etc. And you can pass every checkpoint by just show your face. Questions will come later, actually, because there's a lot to explain about biometrics. But in essence, this is what it's all about. Looking further and further, the end state is that we look for solutions that are reusable and we look for solutions that are interoperable. So once you have enrolled here at Schiphol or maybe at home via a smartphone solution, maybe in the aircraft with Wi-Fi on board, there are a lot of variants to enroll. Once you have been enrolled, preferably we want you to reuse the data not only here at Schiphol, but also at all the airports. Maybe you fly from Schiphol to Charles de Gaulle to New York. It would be very nice and customer friendly and very efficient and very reliable to use the same biometrics as well in Schiphol Airport, as well in Charles de Gaulle, as well as in New York to enter the country. So reusable solutions and interoperable means that you have a physical journey, you as a person, and you have a digital journey, and that needs to be connected to each other. So think big. That's a very, very big thinking picture that will take years and years to achieve that. We want to deliver a smooth, hygienic, and hands-in-the-pocket experience. So that's the vision, a hands-in-the-pocket experience. So if you have your face with you, you can just pass every tap one. And the technology is there. I think you all know it. We have on-the-move recognition, so you walk at the camera, they catch you already before you are there, and they match you before you enter the touch point, and you can just, at a walking pace, go on. As I said, we want to integrate biometrics during the complete itinerary. Easy enrollment is key, because if you enroll and it takes 2 minutes, way too long for passengers, they don't go there. Storing and processing of privacy data, that's what it is all about in this challenge. And that needs to be at a safe manner. I think you have all heard about the GDPR regulations. So privacy is a real issue in this subject. So this concept, what the challenge is about a smartphone solution. Yes, we can enroll passengers via smartphone. It's no problem. We built some, I will show you later on. We built already some prototypes. But the real challenge is how to store that particular biometrics on that smartphone. Because the smartphone operating system is quite hackable. It's easy to jailbreak. And maybe with some artificial intelligence, machine learning or whatever, we can think of solutions that particular part is not hackable. And of course, what is very important as well, choice to the customer. So the customer decides whether or not it will leave his biometrics, and it also decides whether or not he wants to be forgotten. So that's also what is hidden in the GDPR. Think big, but we start small. So KLM started in 2015 experimenting with biometrics, and in 2017 we delivered a complete end-to-end solution. I'll show you a small movie. We did it at Aruba Airport, small island, so it fits in the slogan. Why we chose for Aruba Airport, it's a Dutch kingdom, so and Aruba already has a pre-clearance concept to the United States, and they also want to have a pre-clearance to Europe. And the pre-clearance means that if you need to cross the border at the other side of the ocean, you need to go to all kind of pre-processing checks. Like they swipe your passport, and for example, if you enter the United States, they take a photo of you, they get your fingerprints, and they do all kind of background checks before you enter the country. In a pre-clearance concept, they will do that already at the station of departure. So virtually, they transport the border to the country of departure. And Aruba, that was quite an innovative island, wanted to do that as well to Europe. And that's where we came in, because we transport the passengers from Aruba to Amsterdam. And then we said, hey, if you are going to use biometrics, then you also want to use it for the other touch points, like backdrop, like border crossing, like boarding the aircraft. So I will show you a small movie, very professional, because it was recorded with my own iPhone. But it will show you what the concept is about and how beneficial biometrics can be.
Aruba Happy Flow, a cooperation between KLM, the governments of Aruba, and Aruba Airport.
Is that water?
This is me. My name is Jordi Knoppers, and I work as a customer journey manager for KLM. And among others, I'm responsible for Aruba Happy Flow. At the airport entrance, a KLM staff employee welcomes me and checks the size of my hand luggage. She also checks whether or not I've been checked in already, because we only want checked-in passengers through Happy Flow. The first step in the process is a biometric intake. Firstly, my boarding pass will be scanned. Then, my passport will be scanned. And finally, a recording will be taken from my face. A complex algorithm at the back end compares the photo that is stored in the biometric chip of the passport and the real-life photo that has just been taken. Look! My intake is successful and I may proceed to the next step in the process, the baggage drop-off. And now it's getting really interesting, because I will already be recognized on my way to the desk. You see, a pop-up is displayed and the desk agent can welcome me straightly with my name. And because my boarding pass information is connected to my biometrics, my reservation data is known on forehand. The agent already knows my seat number, my baggage allowance, and who's traveling with me in the same
booking.
Only action that still needs to be done is to wait and label my whole baggage. At Aruba, this will be done manually, because we don't have a self-service backdrop machine yet. I'm now on my way to the third step in the process, the integration of security access and immigration. I may walk on the left side of the bank line, because I'm a Happy Flow passenger. And see, on the right, non-Happy Flow passengers are queuing for the boarding pass scan to enter the restricted area. Because the system already knows that I will cross the border soon, this step is not needed for Happy Flow passengers anymore. Now I will cross the border, and please pay attention to the lady on the right of me. She will pass the border on the regular way, an automated passport control in combination with a real-life photo. My passport was already scanned in the first step of the process. That is not needed anymore. Just my photo is needed for verification, and within 3 seconds I pass the border. Let's go to boarding. Again, only a biometric verification is needed to verify my identity. And as said earlier, the reservation data is already known. The system only wants a new snap of my face. This was the final step in the Happy Flow process. I passed all checkpoints very easily. Currently, we are working on an upgrade of Happy Flow. In this upgrade, off-airport enrollment and lounge access is included. Now it's time to enjoy the service on board.
Well, Aruba Happy Flow, live in operation since 2017. And I already mentioned, I didn't remember it, but the next step in Aruba Happy Flow concept is off-airport enrollment. Read smartphone enrollment, because we say smartphone is the new kiosk. So in our vision, we say actually our travelers has the kiosk in their own pockets. So that's why we are very focused on smartphone solutions. We also are going to see if we can make biometrics reusable by a cross-country solution. So departing from Aruba and using the same biometrics in Amsterdam. Another part of phase two is lounge access. Very important for us as an airline because our most frequent flyers and our most valuable passengers are going into our crown lounges in the world. So it's interesting to connect those databases to the biometrics of our passengers. And last but not least, as I already mentioned, Aruba has already a pre-clearance concept to the US. We don't have it to Europe because of some political issues, but we will go there. But to make things interoperable, we need to connect different biometric platforms with each other. So the US has a huge, huge platform that is built by the CBP. It's called the TVS, the Traveler Verification System. So if you enter the country, they capture your biometrics. The US people store everything and it's reusable by when you exit the country. But we also want to connect it to our platform at Aruba. So we can make it we can test interoperability. And always keep in mind, if you don't follow the GDPR guidelines, we are really F word. So we must treat our privacy data in a very strict and secure way. That's the key message. Well, actually, that was my short introduction to give you a little bit context about the subject. I give the word to Linda, and later on, Maria will also have a word. And I suggest that we, after our speeches, we will be open for every question you have. I think that's it for my part. Thank you very much. Hij doet het weer.
Doet het iets weer? Wat goed.
Ik help hem.
Nee, volgens mij gaat het wel goed zo. Okay, take it over from here. And that's where we saw like this perfect match. So everything that you've seen in the story of Jordi, it's all about biometrics. But how to make sure that we transfer the data in a safe way. And where we also, and that's also where Rutger was talking about, take the sovereign identity part also into account. That's also one of the kind of the earmark of customer experience is giving the control back to the customer. Who are we? And that's also the kind of vision of the GDPR proof. Who are we as KLM, as an institute, having control over your data? And then in the meanwhile, we are kind of in a fight together with Schiphol in releasing your data, yes or no, just in the favor of you. So this whole concept of self-sovereign identity, that's also one of the key elements that is part of this assignment. Of course, you can say, well, the whole DLT is immutable in nature. Yes, that's true. But where we also are looking at is our working with at the stations. So not providing your personal data, so not giving your date of birth, but if it's necessary to know if you're eligible to travel because you're older than 18, then that's the attest that we want to give. And in this case, for example, a visum check can be done before boarding the plane. So these are all the elements where you have to think of. So in this case, Aruba Flow phase two, that's still big, and how to start small. That's where we come in, if you talk about like the possible integration of biometrics and blockchain. So in the digital studio, we have kind of cut phase two in like three subphases, of which we said that the first phase, we're just gonna do standalone, so small in a digital studio. The second phase is going towards the lounge, so meaning we're also approaching our customers, so that our Flying Blue members, they want to ask to join this program. And then phase three, that's really like the long shot, and that's together also with like the government and really talking about pre-clearance, so already being cleared at Schiphol Airport before going to your destination. We divided it in three main features, so registration, how to enroll yourself, authorization and personalization. So zooming in on the first phase, which we are now in a kind of closing stage, we experimented here in the digital studio. So zooming in on the registration part, what we've created, that's a web-based link where you can make a picture of your face and do the enrollment if you are a visitor towards the digital studio. If you are entering the digital studio, and by the way, we are now in the roundup phase and it's taking place in 3-star 2, so the other building that we have, so not this building but the other one. So when you enter the building, you're being authorized and then the checks are being done. If you are the person that you said you are during your enrollment. And there you can also indicate that you want to have a latte macchiato upon arrival. So me, as a resident of the digital studio, I know up front that you are coming and I also see that you want to have a latte macchiato when you arrive. So that's the piece of service that we already want to include in the first phase. We also tested some business and technical hypotheses. Well, we kind of all met them or just proved that it worked. And these are also like the ones that are kind of important to know for you. We were able to make the application fully GDPR compliant. And we said that the guests and the employees are willing to engage with biometric scanners. From the technical side, we've proven that we can make an integration with the orchestra layer of Fishing Box in this case. Fishing Box is also the biometric scanner provider at Schiphol. We build it on Ethereum as our DLT. So jumping towards phase two, so lounge access. So phase one, Digital Studio, was really experimenting on our own employees. The second phase, which we have to start soon, and maybe it will fit in the deadlines or timelines of the hackathon. The launch part is really where we want to contact our customers. So starting again with the registration. In this part, we do not really want to reuse this web-based interface part, but in the meanwhile, we have developed the selfie ID app, which means that your biometric scan that you can do is already integrated in your KLM app. So just for my knowledge, who of you have the KLM app on your phone? Ooh, we should put this as a KPI also to have more people the KLM app having on their phone. It's gonna be a short movie on how the Selfie ID app is now in its prototype phase.
Thank you.
just a sneak preview of our KLM app, where you see that next to the passport part, your biometric scans are there. Oh, just going back. And there, preferably, you would also have to have the opportunity to set your settings. And there we make a distinction in your private or your public data. So in there, you can put in all your private data. There you can choose whether or not to open them to all the other stakeholders. And you can also set your public data. It's not visible in this one, but there you can also say, I want to have a latte macchiato when I enter the lounge. So authorization, when you're entering the lounge, again, with your face, you're recognized, and our gate agents see you in her app. All the ground staff have their happy to help app, where they just have an overview of all the different, it's a nasty word, just to have a nice overview of all the passengers which are passing through. And here she can see that you're eligible to enter the lounge. And up there, it just all depends if you have set that setting open or not. You say, okay, I want to show that I'm a male and that's my date of birth. You could also chosen to not put that setting open. And the public preferences are, I also want to have a latte macchiato and I want to have a window seat in the lounge. So when you are entering, also this lady knows that you want to have a latte macchiato and to want to have a window seat in the lounge. So, and that's again the service that we want to provide to our customers. So these are the first two phases, of which we have now are closing off phase one and entering phase two. Phase three is the virtual ID part. That's much further in the future. Well, we say that you want to register yourself via the municipality. That is actually also out of scope for our KLM assignment. This is, I think, another track which is focusing on the digital identity part from out of, I think it's the Ministry of the Interior. Yeah, I see people nodding. Not specifically this one, but the concept, I think.
We do encourage that teams work together and exchange knowledge. So in this case, and there's a challenge from the Ministry of the Interior on the next generation digital ID part that, yeah, I think building blocks are there, and perhaps also here that could be combined and create epic results.
Yeah, epic, awesome results. Then again, authorization, again at the airport, and here you see that we really want to already do the pre-clearance upon arrival at the destination airport. And regarding the personalization, we don't know, looking at 2 years ahead, on what kind of personalized needs there are. So that's why we just blank it out. So that's all the information so far. Before we jump towards our challenge, I want to invite you all to have maybe a coffee to freshen up, or have a Coke with some snacks up there.
Korte deze vergeten.
All right. Well, let's start again. Nobody went ill, right, from the cookies, so I'm still safe. just a small recap. So we talked about Aruba Happy Flow, the hands in the pockets experience. Just by showing your face, you can cross all touch points. And actually, we didn't mention it before, but our KLM corporate-wide vision and ambition, I need to say, is that we as KLM want to be Europe's most customer-centric, innovative and efficient network carrier. Maybe if you look around somewhere, you will recognize it. I think it's written all over in our internal communication. But it's customer-centric, so this solution is very customer-centric because it's very efficient for the customer and smooth. It's innovative, you can say that again, it's innovative, and especially when you think of the hygienic factor, you don't have to touch anything anymore. Well, in our country that's maybe okay, but there are a lot of maybe Asian countries where the hygienic factor is really an issue. And it's efficient, so if you get rid of all those different varieties of authentication, passport, credit card, boarding pass, then boarding pass and passport, etc. So then you get rid of all those double handling at our handling things. we talked about the four touch points: check-in, backdrop, immigration and boarding. And we look for a scalable solution. I already said it before, a smartphone is a new kiosk. If we manage to find a solution that we can use on a smartphone, think of it, we don't have to invest in any airport anymore, like equipment-wise, yeah, because people carry their own equipment in their pockets. And we fly over 250 airports, so that's a huge investment if we have to equip all those airports with all those cameras, platforms, etc. So that's why we are really, really interested in smartphone solutions. I already said it more than one. We need to do it in our utmost safe manner. It needs to be safe and secure. And with all relevant stakeholders in the ecosystem. Because if you looked at Aruba, there it's a private-public combination, right? Because you enroll at the airport at our touchpoint, it was our kiosk. Then you dropped your bag, KLM's touchpoint. Then you cross the border, you enter security. that's a governance touchpoint. Then you cross the border, it's from the governance. Finally, you get on board, hey, that's an airline touchpoint. So we have the multi-stakeholder concept. And that's very interesting if you talk about privacy data, because how did we manage that? Governance in general are very reluctant to share data, especially when it's about privacy data. So we use the One ID concept of IATA, maybe you've heard about it, where you have a trust framework. And it's a privacy by design concept. Dus everything you developed needs to follow the guidelines of the privacy by design. Why? That's the only way to cover the full privacy. And then you can create a model that when you get at the touch point of KLM, like backdrop, you will be recognized. Then the system will retrieve all the data that is only applicable for that touch point. So we don't see the fines you have. We don't see what is needed to cross the border, because that's not our touch point, that's only for the border. So if you are at the border, maybe the governance can extract every data piece of the system, but we cannot. And the airport is also a stakeholder. They can maybe see how many people will go through their airport, but they cannot see their identity. They cannot see whether it's a male or a female or whatever. So good to realize that we have to deal with a lot of stakeholders in a complete ecosystem. We have to deal with a lot of different legal aspects, because here we have the Dutch legal system, but in China, it's completely different. In Johannesburg, it's completely different. In Bahrain, completely different. The US, completely different. So it's quite challenging. But, and that's where we expect blockchain can help us. That's not my cup of tea, it's more Linus' cup of tea and hopefully your cup of tea, but I was told that blockchain really can help. Okay, the challenge, how to store and process privacy data in a safely and multiple stakeholder setting. So what we would like to achieve with you is to build a concept that when as soon as you have been enrolled on your smartphone and the data is on your smartphone, thus you don't have to have a separate database where we store all those data, but it's on the smartphone of the customer itself. But then it needs to be spoof-free, non-hackable, so not jailbreakable, or how you will announce it. So if I have done an enrollment, I don't want anybody to put another photo on my personal data, so that Linda can travel with her face on my name, you know, if you know what I mean. So that's one aspect, data storage on the smartphone. And then you have the processing of the data. So every touch point needs to get access to the particular data that is applicable to that touch point, if you know what I mean. So, and that's what blockchain might be a good solution for. And there's a third aspect, and I think Maria will come back to that as well. The connection between those two. How are we going to, how do we go from smartphone to the blockchain? And how do we be sure that those data cannot be interrupted by anybody of anyone? So actually that's a challenge. From current to desired state, is that your part, right? Sorry, I just want to keep on talking, but so I will give you the clicker and the microphone. You need some help? Zal ik hem op je...
No, I think that is wel. Top. Lukt. Gaat het? Ja, oké. Oké. Wow. Briefly introduce myself. I'm Maria Steeman. I'm a business analyst here in digital transformation. I've been working on the blockchain cases with Linda, and one of them being also the biometrics case. And I've assisted them with shaping the challenge. So from the current to desired state. At this moment, as you might have heard from the story of Jordi, the Aruba Happy Flow is all involving a central database. And also the proof of concept we are trying to do here, the biometrics case, is also a central database. But we want to lose that also if you're looking at the enrollment of the passenger. So what is the desired state? That's enrollment independent of a kiosk, so the mobile device or maybe a website at home that you can access, or whatever other device that might come up in the future. And the characteristics of this part is it's mobile, maybe it's off-chain. What do we store off-chain and what do we store on-chain? And it's centralized. Well, what we actually mean is it's centralized on the mobile device of the passenger. And on the other end, we have a system where we want it to be decentralized. So every government, every touch point needs to have the information it requires to grant the passenger access to the gate or the country. And we have three tension points. How and what information do we store on chain? How do we then still make sure that the passenger can authorize and authenticate themselves? And how do they interact with one another? How does the more centralized and private aspect of this challenge interact with the on-chain, the blockchain part of the challenge? So for every, so the enrollment, the registration, enrollment via the smart device, how do we store, how do you store the biometrics, in this case facial biometrics and privacy data, locally securely and unspoofable, and GDPR proof. Authentication. How do we make sure that the passenger is eligible to fly, to proceed to the gate, proceed through security, proceed to a country, and which is decentralized on-chain and permissioned platform, and where data or attestations can be exchanged between the stakeholders, so that can be a government, an airport, an airline, in this ecosystem, in an open way, so that new members, new countries, new airlines can access this ecosystem. Authorization, so again, what can a passenger do or not do? Can a passenger fly? Can it not fly? Is there a blacklist of passengers? can a passenger enter the lounge? Can a passenger enter the specific country? Does it have the right visa, etc.? And again, very important, how do we make it all GDPR proof and with a big respect towards the privacy of the passenger? And maybe in addition to this, can we do something with personalization? Like we already mentioned, for us it's very important to have this personal attention towards the passenger, in especially the lounge. Can we come up with something like self-sovereign identity, zero knowledge proof, all those concepts you all are experts on? Can we include them in this challenge? Questions? Not altogether.
I have a question. I'm a little bit confused because in one sense,
I think we have to grab the microphone. Yeah, that's true.
Talk louder as well.
On.
Of course. So I'm a little bit confused. In one sense, you're talking about the touch points have the facial recognition. In the other sense, Jordi was talking about I don't want equipment all over the airports, and I would rather use the smartphone for that. So that's a little bit two sides. Can you explain a little bit further on that?
I can, and I think I need the mic.
Actually, what I was telling about the smartphone solution, that there's a huge potential in smartphones, but before we will be there, I think it will take a decade before we can change everything on the airport, etc. So the coming decade, we are forced to use cameras in airports. So that's why we have all of our cameras installed in Aruba, and we will do at Schiphol as well. We start this year with the rollout of seamless flow at Schiphol Airport. We expect it will take a year or three maybe, but it's all physical camera based. But maybe in my own vision, but at least in the customer experience and in innovation of KLM, we think smartphone, maybe we can let people authenticate themselves at each touch point. Who knows? But that was the reason.
Does it answer your question?
Yes, part, but a question then for this challenge, the hackathon. It would, of course, be a nice disruption if we could skip that part with the cameras.
Of course.
Yeah, so I would try to look for everybody to see if you can really come up with a solution that doesn't require cameras on all the airports and all the touch points.
I would be very pleased.
So if you, for example, go outside, and you say to your telephone, Siri, who am I? And I look upstairs and the satellite takes a picture of me. And then not on the phone, but on a layer, there are some IDs working together, creating that entity. And that I can throw away because I can always go outside and say, Siri, who am I? And then I have a voice and a picture. So those things would also be fun.
The sky's the limit.
Has this already been solved anywhere else in the world?
Sorry.
Has it already been solved Solved.
Or even partially solved in any other place.
On smartphones, as far as I know, no, not. But the world is very big.
So. I thought the world was very small.
Yeah. Oh, sorry. No.
Yeah.
Do you need to repeat my answer? as far as I know, I didn't see any smartphone solution solved if you talk about a safe and secure solution. Who else?
Do you have any particular scope in mind, as in European flights only, departing passengers, international passengers, transfer passengers?
Just passengers.
Passengers in general. Anything will go.
Yeah, anything will go. Of course, we do work with some focus group if we talk about pilots, but and because it's always on a voluntary base if you are going to work with biometrics, so the choice is to the customer. And if you ask us, every customer needs to be needs to have the ability to use it. Maybe it's wise to start with pilots, to start with our frequent flyer population, because they travel a lot with the app already, so that makes it a little bit easier to get adoption. That might be a choice, but from now I would be very open to every passenger and every nationality and every
Okay, I'll give it to you after that. So I have one question. You also showed a beta or minimal viable product, or at least a beta for the your own app where you do the onboarding with the passport and the photo. Will that be in some form available for the participants for the hackathon to build upon that? Otherwise, you have to reinvent that part or rewrite that part.
That's a very good question. I don't have the answer yet, because I also know that we are quite reluctant to bring solutions in open space. But because we want to build something together, I think it might be possible. But I need to check that. But do you know that? Or?
Yeah. You talked about data reuse on other airports. Do you mean then airports where KLM or Air France is situated, or also beyond that, other parties?
Also beyond that, because as you might know, we are a SkyTeam member, and in our SkyTeam we work a lot with other airlines, Korean Airlines, Delta Airlines. That's also a joint venture. And if you buy a ticket at KLM, we can bring you from everywhere in the world to another destination in the world. That's because we are a part of a code sharing network. So if we create a solution for just Air France KLM, yeah, then it's just for us alone. But if you fly from New York to Amsterdam with Delta, and you step over, or you transfer at Schiphol Airport and make a flight to Dublin, with KLM, we want to reuse the data as well. So maybe we don't want to share it with Lufthansa, but that's another. No, that was just kidding, because we are also part of IATA One ID, where we work with the complete airline population with all competitors. So we need to find a solution that is multiple usable, like a boarding pass design, how old fashioned it is. Everybody uses the same concept, with a whether it's a barcode or a QR code. It's completely industry standard, and that's what this solution needs to be as well.
My question, I guess, it's a little bit related to what was just said. You mentioned the One ID from IATA,
yeah.
And I guess, well, there's initiatives on the Dutch government with European level with the ETS. ETS, or there's an European level initiative for identity.
Yeah, IDAS.
Yeah. Right. So what's your vision in terms of integrating with other higher level governmental, European-wide or worldwide kind of initiatives? So how, what shall we keep in mind? Keep it simple, just an ID solution for KLM, or?
What I first need to have the mic before I speak. But what you need to keep in mind is that you find a solution that meets the industry guidelines. So we are an IATA member, like I don't know the percentage, but a highly percentage of airlines in the world are a member of IATA. So we follow that guidelines. On the other side, we follow the ICAO guidelines. ICAO creates a standard for example, passport chips, the way biometrics needs to be stored on your passport chip, the way pictures need to be taken. There are all kinds of standards that is written down in the ICAO standards. And the more generic it is, and the more it fits the industry standard, the better it is. But to be honest, here in the Netherlands, we're quite a popular airline. If you go to China, Beijing, we have just one flight a day. And if you know how many flights there are depart from Beijing Airport, that's huge. So we are actually nothing over there. So standalone solutions is really useless, I would say.
Well, maybe just one additional remark to your question. I think if your identity will be on the blockchain, passports will become obsolete as well. Mm-hmm. So in that way, if you really think about the future, long-term future, I think then the sky's the limit in terms of this use case. So maybe even in that perspective, don't think in boundaries, but also what else is possible on the blockchain in the future and how does that fit into the biometric case in front of us.
I also mentioned like phase three, like the virtual ID part. What I didn't mention is that we are also a stakeholder in a bigger consortium, which is now currently being led by the World Economic Forum. The KTDI part, so non-traveler digital identity. And that's also where they are looking. And I think this answers maybe a couple of questions at the same time. So here we also cooperate with, for instance, the Ministry of Justice and Veiligheid, Security, but also with the KMAR and also with like our counterparts in another country, just to try to see if we can also achieve this seamless flow between like two countries. And that's also where we're also thinking of maybe your passport would be obsolete in the near future because you have it in your phone. So that answers maybe a couple of questions at the same time.
So my question is regarding the other areas of application of blockchain in airline. So for the hackathon, are we just like supposed to focus on this particular area, or like can we approach like other areas like crew logbook, pilot logbook, sanitization, or like internal settlement? I mean, like internal settlement of like ledger books between the departments and like intra airline. So like are these kind of areas across, or like should we just focus on the like digital authentication and the travel experience?
To give you an answer on that one, we're also experimenting with like other business departments, of which like customer experience is one of them. If you're talking specifically about like logbooks for pilots, that's a total other kind of division than we have to be at Flight Ops. So those are like other business stakeholders than we have here tonight. So to give you a straight answer on your question, this is basically the boundary of the assignment, so really focusing on the digital identity of our customers. But if you have other ideas that touches other businesses, then they're also welcome, but I think not for the assignment for this particular hackathon. But I'm still open and interested for other other ideas that goes beyond the scope of this one.
This is like more like a
yeah, so yeah. And to also give you another answer on your question, what we're actually looking for is a working prototype. So we are not literally looking at a new protocol. That's also what we've said on the website, but more kind of an application on it. But it would be very awesome, the state of awesome, if we could like have a kind of a working prototype at the end of this hackathon days. Yeah, Stefan?
Can I offer
question that's for clarification.
So as I see it, what you're saying is I'm looking for two things. One, the identification through my smartphone. Two, the sharing of this data with my stakeholders.
Yes.
So those are two big assignments. Mm-hmm. Is it allowed for a team to say, all right, we're going to assume for part A that we're going to do it like that, but we're not going to touch it, but we want to focus on the B, the blockchain part of the challenge?
I think the interesting part of this challenge is the interconnection of the two. Because on one hand, you have the enrollment of the passenger is quite private on a smartphone, who is by default not connected to the backend, like the blockchain. While the blockchain wants that information to provide the service providers in that ecosystem, the airlines, the airports, to gather the needed data. So I think we can come up with a solution to store biometric data securely, but then how are we going to make sure that that biometric data stored on the mobile device can be used by that whole ecosystem?
Yes, so it's about that part. So I'm not.
That's the
I'm
most team, interesting part.
If
yes.
I'm a team, I'm not going to spend a day on how does this camera recognize my face, etc.
No.
You have experience and technology on that.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Very important. Facial recognition part is already there.
I think it's related to that question actually, because there's a lot of interfaces here, isn't there? So how much of it is kind of known in terms of like the interfaces to the actual solution you're trying to create? Because otherwise a lot of teams can go off and have to do a lot of requirements capture, a lot of like your job, business analysis, I guess. So that could be a lot of duplicated effort across the teams. Is there any sort of a lot of support to make sure that they don't duplicate a lot of overlapping that in terms of specking out exactly what needs to be done in lots of respects, because I think that's going to be a lot of...
So you need more scoping on this challenge?
Yeah, I think so, unless it's already been...
No, I think I agree with you, yeah. I think it's high over, but I think you might need what is already there. Yeah. What can we reuse? What can we use? What do we need to build? Where do we need to focus on?
Because I think you're going to surface a lot of requirements as you go through it, and mm-hmm. there's a way of centrally capturing that for all the teams to kind of, anyway. Yeah.
And I think that's a bit of our homework. We have to, in the preparation towards the hackathon, we have to see what kind of, I think it's going to be like dummy data, because we do not really want to integrate with our operational systems. But we have to see what kind of data we can provide you or expose you to make your solution workable. But that's also like one of the things we have to think of, and looking at Rutger and Stefan also maybe on how to do the preparation on this part properly. So that exactly as you said, that there's not a lot of kind of rework needed if we already have APIs or those kind of things available.
Yeah, so the idea is that when the five teams are registered for this challenge, that they all get to get in contact with you and with us, obviously, and that you kind of create a scenario where specifically you say, oh, we've developed this already. So what do you need from us? And let's see if we can provide you with this.
Yes.
Four teams are saying, I need an expert in field X. Well, let's get an expert in field X at the hackathon. It's that easy. But it's good to also with your remark to not duplicate the effort.
Yeah,
that's
definitely.
Because that's not what you want. You want something new.
Yeah.
And now I will give this to my friend from Vilnius.
Great presentation, great vision, by the way, really forward thinking. I have a question more about data itself, because data is not equal data. It means like, what are the requirements for the BO data? Right, because certain data has to be certain size, like pictures you're taking, what size it has to be, because size, if it's compared about, we're talking about blockchains, size matters, you know, like requirements, like how it's going to be used, so more on that, like, do you have like requirements, maybe encryption as well, like, do you use 256 encryption, or do you use like, you could use global one, because that's again a data.
Maybe I can
help you a bit here. I think these are the kind of things you don't want to ask.
Okay.
before, because they're good questions. But if you would ask, if you go down that path, mm-hmm. you would ask KLM for a full request for proposal. And what? And then you're asking them to basically ask you to get a solution which they could think of themselves, and they can call any vendor in the world for that.
Is there any standard, minimum standard, like for
IKEA?
Okay, the standards. Yeah. The standards will be in the toolbox, so to say.
So that's what I wanted to clarify.
So I have a question as well. when you are showing the presentations, it comes to mind that we are creating some kind of a new type of lock. I mean, entering a country, opening a door, what's the difference? There's a camera there, and through the biometrics it gets unlocked. So in that sense, if I would be a team, I would dive for that mechanism, but that sounds kind of protocolish. So when you just said I'm looking for the app, I can totally understand the application, as in the toepassing. Yeah. So where do you see the biggest opportunity for the teams in that sense? Because if you say, think big, start small, well, this is not a small use case, but the thought for such a lock, where it can be applied, and if you think about, okay, as a consumer, how many times do I have to enroll in a system where my biometrics and identity can be used? What are your thoughts on that?
That's a very good question. Thank you. I have to give myself some time to...
But what do you mean by...
Okay. I will come back.
If you ask me where you need to put your most effort on, because you can just spend 72 hours, right?
So 48.
48? Okay, yeah. Yeah, I need to learn a lot still. For us, it would be very helpful if we find solutions to use smartphone as a device to unlock whatever. That's the big picture. It starts with just the enrollment on your smartphone. If you can manage to make that secure and safe, not the enrollment itself, because we can do it with the storage and make it spoof-free, that will be very useful. Okay. Second is the processing. So if we can think of solutions that we don't store biometrics itself in a blockchain, because people have the right to be forgotten. I don't know how you can be forgotten in a blockchain. So if you can think of such a solution, that would be very helpful. And then, as you already said, the connection between those two.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, but you need to have the A and B before you can make the bridge.
We're really open for creative ideas, building on like existing protocols, Ocean, if that's suitable, Sovereign, IOTA, so these kind of infrastructures. And yes, I can imagine that you want to build like a protocol layer so that it's applicable for like everybody who wants to step into not only this use case concept, but also maybe broader, so in the area of the digital identity or self-sovereign identity just in general. But we as KLM, as part of, or being this stakeholder in this ecosystem, I think for us, the biggest benefit will be in like looking more at the appliances on an existing protocol than really building on the protocol.
Yeah.
I think for us, there is more benefits in the first one than in the latter one.
But to just to get it a bit more sharp,
so in the appliance, there you can look at it from several ways. You can look at it from a front end perspective. Mm-hmm. How does the app look? And that's where a lot of work already has been done. That's really great. And if you look at appliance, is what Jordi also just mentioned, is the part to get the biometrics on the mobile phone, and how the process of exchange between all your stakeholders is done in a way that I keep my sovereignty and I can do whatever I want, what is needed, conform the standards.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right. That's the mechanism you're the application you're looking for. Okay, that's clear.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Of course, as a team, I like to win the challenge. So could you give a list of things that would be extremely cool but totally impossible? So, for example, if I have a password and I have a system that checks that password, but I could tell it in any language, then the system would give back, okay, the password is set, but not store in which language.
Mm-hmm.
I can make a picture of the face, that's one big story, but I can also tell 100 small stories. If they are consistent, then nobody knows my face and I still can go through. I can use three units to provide an entity, an identity. That means that nobody has the identity and it can still work in processes. So I have different lanes to explore new storylines, but I need to know what you guys deem cool, what you say, okay, but if they can build that, then they will be our winners.
I take that, Kevin. I will come back with a list.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah.
So you're part of a chain. This is not only you, it is customs, it is duty-free, it is whoever is going to be connected to this. And even beyond this, you can use it to enter a bank, or you can use it to go into your gym, or
whatever
the ecosystem. To what extent do you already have connections with your stakeholders on this initiative? I mean, are they part of a consortium? Are they in this? Is it a KLM only deal? Do you have data on it?
Up to now, the concepts we built is in the private public sector within the airport. So that means that we have deals, so to say, with the government, with the airport, with the airline, and the suppliers. At Aruba, we are in discussion with Divi Hotels, for example, to see if we can extend Happy Flow. People that stay in Divi can use their face to just go to the room. They don't have to go to check in anymore because we recognize them at the entrance. We know the passport details, so they can just open the door, maybe, with their face. But that's it for now. If you look at collaboration, participation, we work with a lot of airlines in the sense of how can we come with biometrics to an industry standard. So actually the question is quite hard to answer. If you look at our own domain, it's what I said. If you look at worldwide,
of course, but in your own domain, so the collaboration with customs.
Exactly.
That is already established, and that
with the Dutch governance and Aruba governance, it is. But other governance,
no,
it isn't.
Okay.
And within the KTDI project from the World Economic Forum, the Canadian governance is involved as well.
Oh, and that's one technical question. Sorry. On your beautiful iPhone shot video on Aruba, you enrolled. Does that mean that it needs to be done per trip? Do you enroll once? Do you enroll every 3 months because your face is changing?
Well, preferably you enroll once.
Yeah.
As long as the expiring date for your
passport. But from legal perspective, at Aruba, we can only store the data for 24 hours. Then it will be deleted automatically.
Okay.
We start at Schiphol with the same requirements. They are not set in stone yet, but that's
24 hours.
For 24 hours. Okay. But our ideal situation, as long as possible, because we want to reuse it.
Okay, but that depends on legal restrictions.
Absolutely.
Yeah, and that's why also we're looking to store it on a mobile device, because then you're less restricted to keeping it for 24 hours or 48 hours, because then it's dependent on the validity of your passport. Mm-hmm. And otherwise you have to deal with deleting the data or making it inaccessible.
Anyone else?
It's more than an offer I want to make, because I'm also a challenge owner of another track, and there's a lot of AI in this. And together with Singularity, it's a community of 100,000 AI researchers, we will be giving a technical deep dive on how their framework for AI works, with also possibilities to reach out to these 100,000 AI researchers all over the world. It's on March 21st, and of course, your teams would also be very welcome to join this technical deep dive.
Cool.
Yeah.
We have a bit of AI in the workings.
Cool.
Yeah.
21st of March.
Oh, accept that invite.
It's dependent on how many registrants we will have. If it's 130, then it will be in the House of What. If it's more than 130, it will be in the New Relief. We are looking on in which direction we goes. Until now, everybody is very excited about it, so it could be that it is a large group.
Well, thank you very much. Very honored. And I think we will be very interested to join. So,
cool.
I think we will meet.
Yes.
Hi, I'm curious, did you guys investigate solutions with telecom providers? Because you are looking for the solution for the mobile phone. And I'm coming from telecom corporation, and I know that we have some certain capabilities for writing, for example, on the SIM card, right, which is not hackable yet. So there are some solutions there. So the question is, did you investigate that? And is it supposed to work globally? Or is it for the Dutch customers?
To start with your last question, as you might know, we are a transit carrier, which means that about 70% of our population is non-Dutch. So they start somewhere in the world, transfer at Schiphol Airport, and go to another destination. So preferably, it needs to be globally the solution. We talked, just some small talks, with some telecom providers, two actually. But then we discovered we didn't have a match yet in this conversation. I'm very open, of course, to see what might be possible. Maybe the solution is already there, because I can imagine that all over the world people are looking for solutions that are secure on a smartphone. Open to that, not very much mature yet.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And then there was silence.
Yeah, and then there's one last slide. You're welcome to have a drink at our. You're welcome to have a drink in the old traffic tower. Yeah, at the other part of the road. It's all your own cost. I have to say with it, but you're all invited to join.
We will all get together now.
Yeah, so we have to clean it up here. I have to deal with the security first, but then we go out and thank you. Thank you very much.